big welcome to Adastral Park. This is kind of where Tommy Flowers would be working were he still doing his research work today. So Tommy worked at Dollis Hill in the research labs there, the development labs there. And in the 70s, that organisation migrated here to Adastral Park in Suffolk. And I like to think in many ways that this is part of Tommy's legacy. This is a 100-acre research and technology park. We're about 4,500 engineers and scientists here. This is the biggest research and development centre in the technology sector in the UK. And I love to associate this with the legacy of Tommy Flowers. It's a place where we engineer many of the innovative new technologies that my company takes to market, but we also host many, many other technology companies. There are over 50 technology companies on this park now, so there's a whole ecosystem here, and it's all about technology innovation. And we also like to think that we are...
Well, good morning, everybody, and I can offer my warm welcome as well. I'm chilly morning. We're all here for a very special purpose. We're here to celebrate and recognise a global telecommunications pioneer. A global telecommunications pioneer, Tommy Flowers. And at the moment, I have the pleasure of inviting Trevor Baylis to our unveiler in chief, to unveil the thing that we do. But I want to reflect for a moment on the nature of Tommy's work and his contribution to global telecommunications. It was 70 years ago this month that, of course, Tommy created and demonstrated the first prototype of Colossus at Bletchley Park in 1943 during the Second World War. And in doing so, as many of you know better than I, he had effectively created the world's first electronic programmable computer. The first electronic computer. A remarkable technology breakthrough. But it wasn't remarkable just because of its technological innovation. It was an innovation with a purpose. The purpose, of course, at that time, in the dark days of the Second World War, was in assisting code breakers at Bletchley Park, who had been spending their time breaking the Enigma code. The purpose was to deal with something called the Lorenz code. And for the remainder of the war, that machine and its successors, Tommy kept on innovating, producing better versions of Colossus, it was put to incredible purpose. A purpose that quite literally shortened the war, and in doing so changed the course of history. So I think there's an innovation with a very profound purpose that we are celebrating here today. Of course, we know that after the war, the work at Bletchley Park was secret, and therefore I think it's true to say that Tommy never really achieved the recognition he deserved for the technological achievement that has been made. And in a small part, our purpose here this morning is to do a little bit to rectify that. So the memorial we're unveiling here is recognising a profound contribution that Tommy made to not just the world of computing and communications, but to the world in general. And BT is part of that narrative. BT is part of the historical narrative that Tommy leaves us. Because he worked for us, as I said, Tommy, if he was here today, would be working here at our research centre. So he's one of us, and very proud of Tommy in that sense. And I think if I reflect on, I imagine, I can only imagine motivations and the stuff Tommy did, I can see huge resonance with BT's long history of innovation. Many of you won't know, BT is actually the oldest telecommunications company in the world, and we trace our history back 167 years. 46, and to a really interesting bit of innovation and collaboration and purpose. We go right back to a collaboration between the two chaps, an entrepreneur, a chap called William Fosgill Cook, and again, a fellow called Sir Charles Wheatstone, a very famous scientist. And they were really excited about the innovation that was the electric telegraph, and their collaboration led to intellectual property, something I know very dear to Trevor's heart, patents. And led to a great purpose. And that purpose was this mad and wonderful idea that we could communicate over distance. we punctuate that history, not with all the inventions that BT has done, but those elements which are truly world-shaping. We talk in 1926 about the world's first wireless voice transmission across the Atlantic, which was a collaboration between the post office research, that's where we worked, and AT&T Labs, and the prime research laboratory. We then stamp forward a few decades to Tommy Flowers, and we of course punctuate that with the world's first programmable computer. We also did the first electronic exchange, and that was the product of Tommy's research after the war. It was Tommy's team that produced that key milestone and reached to the world's first interoperable exchange. We then sweep forward to a couple of other relations. Clients talk about single fiber. I always have my trough. I get a bit misty-eyed when we talk about this stuff. This, of course, is from this side. This is, as Clive said, pervades communication, pervades everything we do. It's come out of Suffolk. This is the work in the 80s and 90s. And is, of course, part of the excitement that we have here today. And those of you who are able to join the showcase later will see some of those innovations. But I think it's utterly remarkable in that sweep of history that when BT chooses to pick out five or six innovations that change the world, that two of them, are attributable to one individual, to Tommy Flowers, the individual that's celebrating today. And I think that's quite profound. And before I hand over, perhaps I can finish by just reflecting, therefore, on the impact and the meaning that this one, I believe, will have to the young men and women who are doing the sort of stuff Tommy Flowers was doing, people here today, who are the researchers. And I like to think that as they head towards the hub, the centre of our site, I've already given you the numbers, there have been 3,500 BTers, 700 innovators for the other 50-odd companies, as they head to get their lunch, that as they walk past this monument daily, that they will reflect upon the degree to which an individual, perhaps a bit like them, innovative with passion and ingenuity and excellence, working in a place perhaps a bit like this, can genuinely change the world for the better. That's what I believe they will feel as they walk past. And thus, as they head back to their desks and their duties in the afternoon, I'm hopeful there will be a little more power in their elbow, a little more spring in their step, and a little more inspiration in the efforts that they bring to do the really hard job of not just taking technical excellence and great ideas and innovation, but to take it from the lab to the world, which is where people, companies, and societies benefit. That's what I hope and believe will be the mindset and the thoughts of individuals as they head for their daily. So with that, I'll stop. I should really say that the man who needs no introduction, but I will introduce him anyway. We're now going to be unveiling the number two toy. And I guess the main innovation that you are known for is the light radio. Now, reading the brief, I don't know why the light radio is really useful for me on the torch, because I have many devices around my house which are extremely useful. But I believe that wasn't the purpose behind your innovation. The purpose behind your original innovation was actually a much more profound area, and it was AIDS in Africa and the whole area.
By the way, thank you very much. I'm greatly honoured to be here. I always say, chance favours the prepared mind. I don't get up in the morning and say I'm going to invent something. Right? What tends to happen is you have an accident or something, and you think, oh, no, I could have done something about it. You do nothing about it, but a few months or a year later, you see the rest of the thing in a shop window and say, cool, blimey, I thought of that. I'm going to ask you a simple question. How many of you genuinely were taught anything about intellectual property at school? Put your hands up, please. Now that is absolutely disgusting. No! Nobody pays you for a good idea, but they might pay you for a piece of paper which says you own that idea. Now with the help of Mr. Telecom, we can make this happen. I genuinely believe that art is pleasure, invention is treasure. Art. dead cheating for now, the light, dead chocolate. Hot. What about a paper clip? We've all got paper clips, right? We are referring, obviously, to Tommy and what he has done and achieved, along with a team not dissimilar to yourselves. I was brought up during the war when every night was firework night. You understand me? When I was a child, I learned to use a Meccano set, and I could do the most amazing things with my Meccano set, but couldn't write my name. But at the end of the day, back to what I was saying, chance favors a prepared mind. I've always believed in following my heart. Do any of you know what my previous profession was? No? Well, I was a stunt man. I was a lucky boy. When I left my secondary modern school, I did HNCs in mechanical and structural engineering and did day part-time release. By this time, I was swimming for Great Britain and for southern counties, Middlesex, and that led on to me doing crazy diving, which led on to me then becoming a stuntman working with Peter Cook, Doug Moore, Dave Ballard, and David Newton. And then I made enough money doing an underwater escape act in a Berlin circus at the Deutschlandhalle, and I was then able to buy a plot of land on an island where I lived, a roof-high island, and build the house of my dreams. Now, basically, I've always followed my heart. I've always worked from home. There are no pockets in a shroud, you understand? I'm going to ask you another simple question, and if you can't answer, I'll be very surprised. Okay? Mary Anderson. Any of you know who Mary Anderson was? Come along. She was the inventor. Have any of you ever heard of a windscreen wiper? She invented the windscreen wiper in 1903. What about Stephanie Quillick? Another female inventor. No? Well, you're disgusting. She invented Kevlar, right? That bulletproof material that's been used by the military, the army, police, you name it. And yet none of you know. Now I think with the help of British Telecom, we could have all the schools given their knowledge. And I believe that the future rests on the past. We were talking about an opportunity. You've got Bachelors of Art, Bachelor of Science, you've got a Bachelor of Invention. But to be a Bachelor of Invention, you have to file for a patent for something which is socially and commercially viable, and it's clearly never ever been done before. Now, once you've got that patent, you become a Bachelor of Invention, right? Stage two, you start your own enterprise, you become a master, and then when your product goes into market, you become a doctor, right? I want the first, world's first, to be able to be the inventor, to be a little chap called Porter. You might have read about this in the paper. This little boy was three, and his father happened to be a patent attorney. Anyway, Dan was in the garden one day, sweeping the lawn, the stiff room. Then he went to the shed, and got a soft room, and the little boy said, "Dad, why don't you strap the back of the stiff room on the back of the soft room? Then you wouldn't have to keep on going backwards and forwards to the shed." Father did it. He fought for a patent, which is now on the little boy's name. Now, so simple. Now, he didn't go to university, He didn't get a degree. I mean, there's no point being a master chef if you can't find it. You know, that's what it comes down to, achievement being more important. But achievement is what we're looking at today. Let's face it, if it hadn't been for the likes of Tommy and what he was able to achieve, cracking the code, right? I watch the Discovery Channel very often, and it's very, very interesting the number of submarines that came to the end of their destiny simply because of the code breakers. I've been to Martlesham Park and it was quite spooky. Huge wall with valves all over the place, you know, and you're going, oh, no. What's so extraordinary is you look at that now and you say, you won't believe it, I've got one of those in the back of my mobile phone. And technology has come on and on and on. What will be amusing, of course, is in about 100 years' time when I'm dead and buried, they'll be laughing at what we're doing. Isn't it bizarre? When I was a child, the most technically advanced piece of kit I had was a slide rule. Probably the same here, I guess.
By your means.
But can you imagine? They must have been, brain-wise, they must have been light years ahead of all of us, you know? Absolutely extraordinary. And you know, I think the word, in the old days, if I said I was an inventor, they'd say, who the hell is he thinking he is? We are all inventors, right? And we've got to bring this into the community. We should use the history of invention to make our point, and we should focus on people like Tommy here to say, here's a fellow who changed all our lives, all right? Can you imagine what he has achieved? All of us, or most of us, over here in my part of the world, use the old laptop, do a Google search, whatever. When I was a child, you had to go to the library, and chances are the book wasn't there. And if it hadn't been for Tommy, so, what do you think, right? Should we,
I think you should remove the,
Well, what am I saying? It's a great honour to present to you, I haven't seen it myself,
I think we're heading for something that's more than nothing.